So why did you choose to do masters? Why do you want to proceed with your masters?
Okay, so for me, as I was working in the tech industry for last 2 years, so let me tell you that two kind of people who are working in the tech industry. So especially for when it comes to information technology and all those sort of fields. So in engineering, you have two people who are innovating in a company. There's one set of people who are managing everything. They are so-called managers and, you know, the management side. And the other side are people who are working for engineering, who are working on innovating products, who are, you know, creating something which the customers can really use. For example, let's say a lot of you must be knowing about Facebook and you know, or Google. So all these companies are driven a lot by innovation in the products. And again, there is a management side. So while I was in the industry for last 2 years, I figured out really for myself that, you know, there's a lot of dilemma between what people want to do. They want to go for management or they want to go for the engineering side of things. And I realized my passion since my bachelor's, before my bachelor's, was computer science, and it's really something, engineering is something, innovation is something that drives me, and I really want to pursue that. Now, to succeed well in the industry, you need to have, bachelor is your basic step for whatever field that you're working. If you want to get into advanced innovation stuff within your company or outside your company, you need a sufficient degree or depth in the knowledge. So that's when I decided that, okay, master's or a PhD might be something that can give me more depth in the field that I want to pursue. My research area, my interest area is artificial intelligence and distributed computing. And I really found that out about myself that in the last 2 years, this is something that really excites me. And that's when I decided, okay, I should be going for master's. And I really believe the computers as such, you know, there's a lot been happening in the last decade in the field of computer science, and a lot, and I anticipated a lot as more is going to happen in the coming and future. So a lot of things are going to happen, a lot of lives, millions of lives of people are changing, you know, the way computers have affected each one of us, it's dramatic. They have a very grand role in the way we live our life, and I believe that this role is going to become more and more significant in the coming years. And it's that part, it's that aspiration that someday I may develop something which can affect a lot of life on the people. It's that's my ambition, and that's what excites me. And that is why I want to go for MS in specialization, and currently I want to go for, my interest area, as I mentioned, is in artificial intelligence and distributed computing. You must have all have heard about Siri, how Siri is powerful with the Apple iPhone. So that's one of the aspects, one of the applications, real world applications of artificial intelligence. I anticipate that in coming future, this role, this field has a lot of potential. And given my creativity and my passion, I can really do well in this field, and I can develop something which can really you know, help a lot of people in the world. So that is why I want to go for MS. I'm not sure as of now about PhD, because PhD is a 5 years commitment. And probably research requires a lot of commitment. So as of now, I'm sure, okay, I'm going to go for MS. And depending on how well I perform in my master's, I may choose for a PhD, or let's say I want to go for a research tech job. But that's for a later point of time. As of now, I am thinking about only for master's.
Wow. In a way, without innovation, not only computer science, any field might actually become very saturated.
Exactly.
Like,
exactly.
And I mean, we've seen all this artificial intelligence and I mean, things like this only in movies. Like, it is really fascinating to see people working on intelligence. Previously, only electricity and water was something which we cannot exist without. But now, computers have also become an essential part of our lives. No one can imagine our life without computers now. So it's glad that you've also chosen such a field and you're going to work on it. And now, Sarah, can you tell us more about your dream university? What motivated you to choose a target score of 335 plus? What was it, your dream university?
So first of all, I started looking around what are the top universities in my field of area, in my field that I want to pursue in master's, and what are their expectations. So everything started from there, and I figured out that these universities, whether it's Stanford, whether it's Berkeley or Georgia Tech, they require at least a score of GRE score of 330 plus is considered better for these universities because a lot of people are applying for them. So that's when I decided my target score should be somewhere around 330 plus, and 335 seemed reasonable. And let's say a lot of people, you know, at this point there was also an intuition, let's go for 340, if I not get forward for 340. But again, you have to be a little realistic as well. Take stock of the time that you have left. And I'm not sure, I'm not saying that don't set 340 or don't say 330. Don't restrict yourselves, but be practical about what you can achieve. So taking stock of those things, I found 335 was goal that I wanted to achieve. Again, while selecting these dream universities, my major criteria was that what is the amount of research, how many good professors are there, and what is the reputation of that particular university in that particular field. For example, Stanford University runs a very popular course on Coursera by the professor Andrew Ng on artificial intelligence. So, and I attended an online course, and I found that professor very enthusiastic about his research. So that's how I shortlisted Stanford. Again, Stanford is the best. And again, you have to also look about, let's say, if you don't want to go for your research, or you want to go continue with a job in the industry, also look about what is the placement and record of that particular university. So placements, overall ranking of that particular university, what is the research output, and are there professors for your kind of research, and also the number of alumni, how many people. So I have some of my seniors. If you have seniors in these universities, great, talk to them, how is the culture over there, what is like to study over there, that can help. And what is the breadth of research area? For example, let's say, as of now, I feel that artificial intelligence is something that I want to do, but let's say if I go to the college, are there more research areas available in that particular university? And again, there's always a trade-off between the ranking and the placement and versus the research area. But I think one rule of thumb should be, if you want to go for just masters, look at the placement records, their overall ranking. If you want to go for research or a PhD degree, look for, are there good professors or, you know, a sufficient research in the field that you want to go for study? So these should be the guiding criteria for how you want to shortlist the universities. And that is how I did university shortlisting.
Right. Now, Saurabh, when it comes to university, students have few questions. Say, for example, should I definitely have a work experience, prior work experience, is one question that students always ask. What is your suggestion?
So it's work experience. When it comes to masters, there are two kind of, for example, let me talk about masters. When it comes to masters, there are two kind of tracks. One track is purely driven by coursework, and the second track is which is driven by research oriented things. So if you are going for research oriented tracks, whether it's masters or it's PhD, work experience may not matter that much. Obviously it's a plus, but it may or may not matter that much. But if you're going for a coursework-driven master's or a course, in that case, there are a lot of people who are applying to these programs. They are essentially people who have a lot of work experience. So in those tracks, when you are applying for a master's driven by just purely coursework and credits, your work experience may have more weightage than the other areas and than the other track. But essentially, if you're going for master's, you're going for master's because you love that subject. You want to pursue, read more about that subject. And it's okay for universities that even though you may or may not have work experience, what matters will then, if you don't have work experience, what will matter then in that case will be your SOP, and you must have research publications in that case if you're aiming for top 20 or top 30 universities. So that's my overall outlook is. But yeah, in some cases, if you have too much of a work experience, let's say if you have delayed, let's say 10 years, and then it may or may not be looked upon as a positive sign by the universities, because universities want that, what universities are looking for you is that they want that the students who are able to complete the coursework. So the more you're away from your university or your college, let's say the more you have spent time in your industry, the universities tries to look upon those students as people, you know, they cannot study that much, but then you have to prove your point again that, okay, I can complete that coursework which universities assigned. So it's always a mix of situations. And again, as I mentioned, if you're applying for a master's which has a coursework, which is coursework driven, then definitely work experience will count. If you are not applying for a master's, which has a coursework, it's more of a research oriented, or if you're applying for a PhD, work experience may be a plus, but it's not that much necessary.
Okay, while you were talking, students here, Shivesh and Simar had this question. How do you define this coursework driven course or research work driven course? What is the perfect definition for each?
So perfect definition is that if you go to a university, for example, if you go to the website of University of Madison, it mentions, so they have a separate program also called as professional masters. So professional masters, in that they have specifically called out they're looking for people with work experience. So that's one way of identifying. The other way is that, for example, look at how the master is, what is the time duration and what is the degree requirement, completion requirement of that particular master. If you go to the website of, let's say, University of Madison again, you'll find that they have two tracks. One track is that in one track you have to submit a mini thesis to complete your master's, and in the other track you have to finish, let's say, 196 credits or 200 credits to complete that master. So depending on what is the degree, most universities have published their degree fulfillment criteria. If the degree fulfillment criteria is a mini thesis, then that's a research work oriented master's. If the degree fulfillment criteria is just the credits that you have to fulfill, then that's a coursework driven master's.
Oh, all right. So that should be a totally new information and direction to all our students. Very much for that, Sarah. Now, guys, I've seen a lot of questions from you regarding research publications and all. So we are going to discuss everything in detail. Shall we all discuss further with Sarah and learn more and get back to questions? All right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Sarah, what do you plan after your master's?
So, like I mentioned, after master's, so I have a lot of inclination for doing innovation and research. But as of now, I'm not much sure that whether PhD is something that I want to go for. So after MS, I have two options. I have kept open primarily two options. One option is either I take up a job with one of the tech giants, and the other thing, tech giants in Silicon Valley. Again, that would be, after I have done my master's, I'd be able to get more research-oriented roles in those companies. The other aspect is that the other choice is that I go for my PhD after my master's. I will decide that depending on how well I'm able to do research. So because research is a lot about, generating ideas, coming up with your own direction for a particular field. And sometimes it's people just go for mass PhD thinking that they would get it, but believe me, it's not that easy, because generating ideas, it takes time. So the way I have thought about this, let me go for master's as of now. I'll take up a master with a research oriented track, and depending on how well I perform in that, how well I form my connections in the university, how well my professor's recommendations about my future will be, I'll take either a job or a research oriented job, or I'll go for PhD.
Wow, that's very clear. That's a very clear path you have. Now, all of us have gathered here to ask a lot about his GRE plans and preparations. How did he manage to score his master 333, isn't it? Saikat, Samruti, a lot of you want to know about it. How many of you want to know how he prepared for his GRE? How did he plan to score such a great GRE score? How many of you would want to know? I guess all of you. Yes? Now tell us, Sarah, tell us how did your journey begin? How did you start preparing for your GRE?
Okay, so I started about thinking about GRE, I started thinking about masters from July itself. And it was July until August and I spent most of July figuring out what are the universities, what are their deadlines. And it was only till August till I realized that I have to give a GRE, and I need a good GRE score for that matter. So I started planning for GRE that, okay, I have August and I have 3 months before I can, get till November till I can get a GRE, and then I can apply for universities by December. So I started thinking about from August, and it was only in the first week of September that I joined GREH, and before that I spent mostly August again figuring out what are the best online preparation materials for GRE. And the reason I needed a online preparation was that because I was working, so I needed something that would keep me track on my preparation. I needed something that would develop a routine for me, because mostly when you're working, you tend to drift away most of the times in your work, and you try to put things on back burner for your GA preparation. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to be regular, and I felt that attending a coaching or attending something, a preparation program, will help me keep track on that particular thing. But since I was working, again, the problem was that I could not attend a regular program in Delhi here. So I started looking for some online preparation material, online preparation course. And that's when I found GREH. It had a lot of good reviews. And I really like their idea concept of, you know, one-to-one mentorship. And that's when I thought, let's give it a shot. So it was from the September when I started preparing for GREH. And the first question my SFA asked was that, what is the time that you want to, you know, put for your everyday preparation? I said, and since I am working, I cannot put more than, after work, I cannot put more than 2 to 3 hours of preparation every day. Yeah, but probably on the weekends, I can stretch it to 6 to 7 hours. So that was my the time that I devoted, general time that I devoted for my GREH, 2.5 hours every weekday. And on the weekends, I used to stretch a little more and, you know, put 6 to 7 hours on Saturday and Sunday. So,
Now, Saurabh, while you told us that you were spending 2 to 3 hours on an average per day on a weekday, and during weekends mm-hmm. you spent close to 4 to 5 hours. But here we also see some students who are working. They are hardly able to squeeze 1 or 2 hours per day. So if they are provided with a proper plan, like how you were provided with a plan by your SFA, if they are also provided with a plan, will it be useful for them? If yes, yeah, how?
Yeah, definitely. So my SFA asked, so there were lots. So GREH has this program, this lesson on advanced mathematics practice. So sometimes I asked, so my SFA asked me that whether you will be able to do those lessons or not. So I told them, okay, since I'm able to give 3-4 hours, I should be able to do them. But again, she said that since if you are not able to do that, you can skip them and then you can just focus on the basics of those lessons. So entire plan was designed based on how much hour I can put in. So let's say the GRE Centum program which I joined, it had around 7 full-length tests. And at the end, I told them I won't be able to complete 7 full-length tests or for each GRN verbal. Then the SFA suggested me just complete 3 to 4 SFA full-length tests, and that should be able to give. So the entire program is, designing. So since let's say if some people have 1 or 2 hours, then SFA can really help you figuring out what areas you are weak in, and then you can concentrate more on those particular areas. For example, for me, quant was little easier. So I told my SFA I want to give more time for verbal, and that's when on an average 2 to 3 hours every day I used to spend around 1 to 2 hours, at least more than 50 or 60% of time on, or about 70% of time on verbal and 30% of time on my quant preparation. So your SFA can, you design your entire schedule around that, how much time that you have, and let's say even if you have 1 or 2 hours on when after your office, and let's say you are spending 5 to 6 hours on your weekend, that should be enough for you for GRE preparation. If you are working in a methodical manner, if you're practicing the right set of questions, because if you're working on 100 easy questions, and if you're working on 10 difficult questions, there's a lot of difference between them. So practicing same questions. So GRE preparation is all about figuring out what areas you are weak in, and then focusing more on those areas. And this becomes more crucial when you have more or less and less time. You have to be more specific, as the sooner you realize what are the areas that you're weak, and your SFA can definitely help you, and the practice diagnostic test and all those things can definitely help you figuring out what are the areas that you're weak in. So first figure out what are your areas of weak areas, and then start planning accordingly. And in that case, definitely, even if it's 1 or 2 hours every week, and if you're, but the only thing is that you have to be diligent and regular in your preparation. You cannot say, okay, you cannot skip lessons. And even, let's say, in my case, what used to happen was that in some days I have to stay late at office and I was not able to catch up with my lessons. But I always made it a point that I'll go back on the weekend and I'll put in that extra hours. So you have to be regular. You have to keep keep your backlog as minimal as possible. Identify what are your weakest areas. If you have less time, focus more on them first and be confident about what you have. And don't be too overconfident. For example, let's say if I have my quant is good, I should not become too overconfident. I should keep practicing on them as well. So those are the basic things I think you should keep in mind when you're working. Yeah.
All right. Now, when you were talking, a lot of the students were asking questions about how did you prepare for the GRE verbal section, because that is the most difficult section under the perception of students. It's difficult to score 160 plus in the GRE. So I don't know, how did you feel about GRE? You can share us with that, share us all that. And now, guys, we are going to discuss in detail about how he prepared for each and every section in the GRE exam. And we should also begin with the verbal preparation section, because you'd all be anxious about it. Saurabh, please share with us your verbal preparation techniques.
Okay. So, you must be knowing that the GRE verbal section has three parts. There's a reading comprehension part, there's sentence completion, and then a text completion section. So, of these three, what you can easily master is the reading comprehension part. And that is where I started. I started because success in sentence completion and text completion is dependent largely on your vocabulary. So as long as you haven't developed that strength in that vocabulary, you can at least delay the preparation for those sections, because you can only going to frustrate yourself if you start preparing just with these sentence completion and text completion. Reading comprehension is something which everyone, I believe, can really excel at if you prepare in right time, with right pace. So that's a section I started with, and I reading comprehension part of GRE Edge is really comprehensive, and they have a lot of practice sessions around that, around 10 lessons. That's more than sufficient, and they have graded it based on the levels of difficulty. So practice lesson 1 is little easier than practice lesson 2, and so on and so forth. So I started first with my reading comprehension part, and I first grasped what are the basic type of questions that can be asked. So I figured out there are only three or four types of questions that can be asked on reading comprehension part. One is your factual based questions. The second part is your inference based questions. Third is you have to find summary, look at the whole paragraph. And fourth is again, finding the meaning of a word relevant to that particular section. So first figure out what are the four or five parts of reading comprehension question that you think are there, and look at what questions you are comfortable with. I'm sure most of us will be comfortable with the factual questions. Some may find the entire finding the summary or the finding the intent of the passage as simple. Some may find inferential questions as simple. So figure out what is simple, what is difficult for you from these reading comprehension. Go through their basic techniques of solving. What is the basic techniques that are required to solve those questions? Once you have figured out, you've got your basic techniques written or assimilated all those reading comprehension, practice. That is the only rule that is the only mantra for reading comprehension. Practice as much as you can. And since reading comprehension is something which is going to your as you spend more and more practicing, you will start to figure out a pattern in all these questions. That okay, inference. Whenever there's an inference based question, this is how they start. Whenever there's a factual based question, this is how they start. So when it comes to finally attempting those reading comprehension on the GRE exam day, the confidence that you will have is that you look at the paragraph, you look at the length of the paragraph, and then you look at just the basic question, and you will know that okay, this is an inference based question, this is going to take more time, or this is just a factual based question, let me do this right away. So that having that clarity, okay, what question type is a particular question is without reading the paragraph. So your practice level should be such that just by reading the stem of the question, you should be able to figure out how much time this question is going to take, because that is the key. Because in GRE, there's a lot of reading comprehension. There are 3 to 4 reading comprehensions. Each has around 3 to 4 questions. So if you're able to master this art, look at the question and then just figure out, okay, this question is asking me to infer something. I have to read the entire passage. I don't have time right now. Let's skip this question. Or this question is just asking for a factual information from this paragraph. I'll just read this paragraph and I can answer this question. So this kind of keeping this thing in mind will definitely help you speed up your through reading section. Now for sentence
So,
comp
tell me, Sarah.
yeah so for sentence completion and text completion section, it's totally based on your vocabulary. So start practicing your vocabulary but from day one. Start learning 10 to 20 or 30, 40 words every day, what is the maximum that you can. And then again, vocabulary module of GREH can help. So yeah, I can, yeah.
Okay, now you were asking us, I mean asking students to learn close to 20, 30, 40 words. Is it compulsory that they should learn so many words, or is it okay if they learn according to their capability?
I think it can depends on how much time you have. Let's say if you have, let's say my case, I had only 2.5 months. And given that a GRE preparation requires that you know at least, if you take a stock of how many words that you have to learn for a GRE preparation, for an average student, I think that will be around 2,000 words. Now, 2,000 words in 2.5 months, you can do some calculation around it, because when you're learning a word, if you, we all tend to, you know, go for a specific pace for ourselves. Let's say, oh, I can only learn 10 words, or I can only learn 20 words. But when you're learning a word, it's just not you're learning the meaning of the word. You have to learn the usage of that word. A lot of things goes around for a word. So I think if you have time, let's say if you have more than 3 months, 4 months, or 5 months, then you can go learn at your own pace vocabulary. But if you have less time, let's say 2 months or 3 months, or let's say even 1 month or 1.5 months, then definitely you may need to speed it up, because at the end, it might happen that you have, let's say, 100 or two, or you have 500 odd words remaining, and just cramming them won't help you case in at the end. So pace yourself according to the time that you have. I know we all want to, you know, go for our comfort zone. Okay, I can only let's learn 20 words or 30 words, but again, it all depends on how much time you have, and you can push a little further. I think 40 words or 50 words doesn't matter. What matters is that how quickly you are able to relate that word with your understanding, and how quickly are you able to recall and use that word in your day-to-day usage. So that is it.
Okay. Shivesh here wants to know, what method did you use to remember GRE words?
Okay. So first, I started with the vocabulary app of GREH. So it has pictures, and you know, it really helps you know the picture, and the antonyms and the synonyms really helped to get an idea of that. But I spent around one month going through that vocabulary app, and the major challenge for me was that there were some words which I knew and some words which I didn't know. So it was difficult. Whenever I have to revise, I had to go through that entire list. So I came up with a strategy, was that let's write down every word that I don't know in a separate notebook. And so after going through that vocabulary app, I mnemonic vocab picture word list, I also looked around at what is the entire possible list of word list that is possible for that GRE can ask. So you can get that word list from your SFA, or if not from your SFA, you can get from it from any GRE books like Barron's or something. So get that entire word list, let's say of 3,000 odd words. First go through that word list and figure out what are the words that you know. Strike away those words from that list, because try to reduce the noise. For example, we are learning, let's say, 3,000 words. If you sit down to revise those 3,000 words, that's too much. So your goal should be to prepare a list of the words that you do not know in a separate notebook. And let's say, for in my case, that was around 2,000 words I came up with that I did not know. Then every day I used to go for, let's say, about 20% of that words. I used to go through 400 words quickly and figure out of those 400 words, what are the words that I now have and I know, and I can strike them off the list. So I keep on reducing. So and the words which I did not know, I used to learn, let's say, and I kept that, okay, I learned 40 words, but I'll revise through 400 words and I'll see if I can remember those 400 words from the past day. And every day I used to keep on, you know, my target was to keep on removing words from that 2,000 odd list. And by the end of my GRE preparation, from the last week of my GRE preparation, I had just 200 words which I did not remember correctly. So keep this And when I say that you strike off the word, you strike off the word only when you know it's a synonym, you know, you have assimilated it, you can recall it any point of time. And the other thing which really helped me while remembering my vocabulary was that I brought a whiteboard in my room, and I used to write words, let's say whatever words I have learned for last 3 days, I used to write those words on the whiteboard, so that whenever I am coming around and going around my room, those words were in front of my eyes. And I used to quickly stop for a minute, and I used to scan through that whiteboard looking for a word that I did not know, circle that word, and let's say if I found that word which I was very well acquainted with, I used to remove it from the whiteboard. So this exercise of reducing, because every time, let's say if you in your back of your mind, if you have that nagging that, okay, I have to go through 3,000 word list, that feeling itself is too much overwhelming. So try to reduce that unknown, that how many words that I do not know. So from to prepare a list of all the words that you do not know, keep on learning from that word list and try to reduce that word list. And write, and even sometimes, you know, if you just, let's say you have learned 40 words. Next day, try to recall from your memory what were those 40 words, write them down and write short sentences for them. Of those 40 words, I'm pretty sure you will remember only 30 words. Try to look at all those 10 words which you did not remember and write them on your whiteboard or whatever. So this strategy really helped me in preparing for vocabulary.
That was a really nice strategy. Like, I've never heard anyone talking about like writing it on a word whiteboard and just looking at it. It definitely works because you see it every day. So it definitely, I mean, you'll be able to visualize it anyhow, like when you come across a word in the exam.
Right. Yeah. And try to, whenever you're learning a word, try to gather the synonyms of a word. For example, let's say there's a word called opprobrium, and there's a lot of words which opprobrium, libel, there's a lot of words which mean the same thing, which convey the same idea. Try to gather those words in a single page, and when you look at those words, try to look at those words in a single cloud or some sort of, you know, a circle sort of thing, so that you are able to draw conclusions, and it will really help you in figuring out close cases, that what is actually a difference between a libel and an opprobrium, what is the difference between a calumny. So a GRE often gives you, when it comes to synonyms or sentence completion, these close cases are really important. And take good care of you understand verb form, what is a word form, is it a noun, is it a verb, and what are its related forms, and that can help you with the synonyms as well.
Right. I've also shared the list of word lists, guys. These are called theme-based word lists. Arav was talking about classifying words and forming a cloud. We've just made it simple for you. We've already formed the clouds. All you have to do is just memorize all those words or learn these words, the synonyms, everything that is that goes along with the word. I've shared the link with all of you. And now we have a fair idea about how to prepare for the verbal section. Shall we move on to the quantitative reasoning section, guys? All right. Most of the engineers find it very easy, slightly easy to prepare for the quant because they stay in touch with the subject. And some of the students who are not in touch with the subject find it really, challenging. In fact, they feel scared to start their preparation. So how did you prepare for the GRE quant?
Okay, as Manu mentioned, so I'm already an engineer, so yeah, that may be a little easy for me. Quant was a little easy, but again, the general advice I want to give for everyone is that quant is, so you already have we all have done our high school mathematics, so GRE maths is something which is not difficult. All that you require is a strategy. Let's say even if you're not very much confident with quant, start with the very basic lessons. And start first with the areas that interest you. Let's say from your memory, you might find that profit and loss is something that you really wanted. It was really something easy for you. Start your quant preparation from those topics which you find, if you have some interest or you found relatively easy, go through them first and practice questions from that. And then start moving towards the topics which you found really hard in your high school. Now, here one thing that you will want is that even for the sections which you feel that, okay, these are pretty easy, I can ace through them, do not become too much overconfident, because GRE, in GRE there are some questions which seem very simple, but they are tricky questions. So always focus on your accuracy. As of when you start your preparation, don't get too much worried about, you know, I'm spending too much time in solving quant questions. Just your focus should be in your accuracy. Even if, let's say, in an hour you're able to do 20 questions and you are able to get 19 or 20 of them right, that's fine. Because speed is something that you can develop towards the end of your preparation. At the start of preparation, focus on getting the accuracy. And what I find is that most people, you know, they get entangled with, they don't want to practice. Please practice. Please practice as many questions. Don't delay. Just don't get yourself bogged, because quant is all about practice. You practice on the day one. Don't delay. Don't just, you know, just don't just, let's say when you're revising a section, just don't go through the basic concept and say, I'm done. Your preparation for a particular lesson in quant is only done when you complete the entire practice lesson for the section. It's just not the formulas. Remembering the formulas won't help. So practice in quant is must. Start with your the topics which you are comfortable, and then don't become overconfident. For example, let's say if there's a question which you feel you think is very, and this happens usually with the questions when you have to, you know, there's an option to choose between whether, when you have to compare columns. The comparing columns question is something which is really tricky for GRE, and when the question is really simple, it often becomes, people often used to get tend to do mistakes on that. So pay close attention when you are solving those questions. Play your accuracy is very important, and when you are revising a lesson, see why you got a question wrong. What was that thing that made a question wrong? If, as long as it is, you know, you did not know the concept behind, it's okay. But if it was something that, you know, a silly mistake in calculation, or you missed to take account into a case, those questions should be marked for revision at the end. And so that is how I think quant should be. And yeah.
Okay, so here students generally what they do is they feel confident about quant, and they try to just revise the formulas before the exam, and then they just go forward to take the exam. I mean, it is definitely not advisable, but for students who are already good at quant, so is it advisable to spend lesser time on quant and focus more on verbal section?
Yeah, definitely. If as simple as if you are confident with quant, you can spend more time of your preparation in verbal section is definitely advisable. Just that be keep your quant. Don't, let's say if you're confident in quant, don't say that, okay, I'll practice my quants towards the end. Right from the time when you have started your GRE preparation, let's say in my case it was in September, start practicing quant. Even if you're practicing one lesson a quant, that is okay. But practice regularly. Don't say that, okay, I'll do quant at the end. Because what happens is then there's verbal sections become too much overwhelming, and then you start to, because if the whole quant preparation is about confidence. If you're confident, you can easily solve all those questions correctly. So if you're practicing regularly, it is going to help you build confidence. And even if, let's say, if you are, let's say I'm okay with quant, I know a lot of concepts. So my advice is that quickly finish your lessons, whatever the lesson is, spend time in practicing. And for GRE, I think each lesson has a practice lesson of around 10 questions. So you can do 10 questions in 20 minutes. I don't think so. 10-20 minutes is too much time. So the idea is practice regularly. Even if you are confident in quant, make it a point that you're practicing each and every topic regularly. Even if it's, let's say, 10 minutes every day. But yeah, make sure you are accounting for quant preparation every day in your routine, and that will help you.
That's really nice. Saurav, next we are going to discuss about your analytical writing assessment preparation. But before that, I was just discussing, like, when we began this discussions about the seminar, I also got a chance to talk to your trainers, and they were always telling me that you were very consistent in your performance. Like, your first test and your last test, you were consistently improving one in every test, and you were maintaining it till the end. And in fact, even the test which you took for the GRE exam, you had maintained it. So what is the secret of your improvement? How did you progress so consistently?
So one thing is that I always prioritize your stuff. So, for example, let's say even So for consistency, let's say for my at this point of time, applying in universities is something which is top priority for my career. And if you have got your priorities right, you will definitely get, you know, worried that okay, I have to perform. So I usually prioritize my stuff that for my for let's say for next 2 months, GRE is something that I want to dedicate. I will shut down everything. I'll dedicate consistently focus on this thing. So no matter how much time I had put in for, you know, office or for parties, or I'll curtail that time if I'm. I'll not say that I won't do that, but my priority first is GRE. So that is something that I always kept in my mind. My priority should be GRE for next 2 months. And as regarding improvement, what most of us do is that, you know, we take a practice lesson and we just say, okay, I got this much score and I'm above so many people. That's fine with me. And let's say if I take a quant practice test and I got out of 20, I got 18 questions right, I will feel very much elated. But take a little step back and look at why you got those two questions wrong. So this there should always be something in you which should say why I'm getting a particular question not right, whether it's a verbal section or whether it's a quant section. After a test, revise, spend more time in looking at those questions you got wrong and what is the reason that you got those questions wrong. So that will help you, and that will help you improve scores. So what most of us do is that we say, okay, I got out of 20, I got 18 questions right in quant, that is fine with me. I don't care about those two questions. Don't do that. Look at why, because those two questions took your time in the test. And you said a particular reason that, okay, this was something should be there and you did not get it right. So identifying why you get a question wrong is very important. And second, prioritizing your stuff. Okay, for what is and that will help you definitely improve, be consistent, and then improve your, you know, performance in the school, in the exam.
So just taking tests alone is not important, guys. You have to go back to the answers, see what are the questions that you've got wrong, and then you have to get back to your performance and check whether, check how you should improve. That is what Saurabh says. That's really nice.
Hello.
Excuse me, guys. Now, Saurabh, can you tell us about your AWA preparations? How did you prepare for your AWA section?
Okay. Yeah. So AWA was little. Something I was little worried about, because AWA is not that easy. At least I did not find AWA that easy. So first thing I did was that go through the fundamentals of how do you answer AW question, and there are two aspects to it. So there are two types of question that you have to answer in AWA: analyze an issue and analyze an argument. So analyzing, and I'll talk first about analyzing an argument, because that's an easy part of the AWA. In analyzing analyzing an argument, it's very there are three to four types of basic fallacies of reasoning which you will find that, you know. First is which after going, you know, solving a three to four types of questions in AWA analyzing an argument, you'll find that one type of fallacy is that, you know, drawing conclusion from a small sample. Or the second type of false fallacy which can occur is that generalizing from a very specific set of things. And our third type of thing will be not backing your claim with sufficient data. So there are three to four types of three to four types of benchmarks on which you can evaluate a particular argument, and most of the analyze an argument will have these three to four problems. And as your SFA might have mentioned, that when you're writing for analyzing an argument, if you're able to identify three flaws in the argument, that's more than enough to get a good score. In my case, you try to first figure out what are these three to four types of things, things in the arguments, which flaws in the arguments, which are generally there in every type of question which is there in analyzing an argument, and then start writing those three to four questions, and that should be easy. For analyzing an issue was something that really was challenging for me, because in that 30 minutes on GRE, you have to come up with 3 points for that issue. You have to come 2 points which support your argument and 1 point which is which kind of refutes your stance, but you're able to defend it. So you have to, whenever you're writing for and analyzing an issue, you have to take a balanced stand and you have to come up with something which is for and against. And ideally three main paragraphs in the body is something which is considered a good. Now the problem with most that I usually faced was that I was not able to generate ideas in that 30 minutes because I used to overshoot my time. So I was really, really worried, and then I really got this idea that the ETS has published everything on what all possible pools of topics there can be. They have published it on the website. So what I did was that I took that 20 page printout of the entire essay analyze an issue section that is there. And although it seems that there are 200 odd topics, if you actually go through those 200 topics for essays, you will find there are 30 to 40 themes only. You can characterize the entire 200 essay into just 30 to 40 themes. And I spent a day, and on that day, what I did was that I used to pick up a topic, think three things about what as three topics, just 3 points, spend 5 minutes thinking 3 points for each topic, write them down and move on to the next theme. So I did this exercise for a day and it really helped me in gaining my confidence. Okay, the topic which I got in my GRE exam was not something which I had practiced, but that exercise of going through every topic and in just 5 minutes coming up with 3 points, it really helped me to actually solve the question which I did not see in the final exam. So GRE AW is also about generating ideas, how quickly you're able to generate ideas in a given span of time, and then you're able to write it quickly. So this exercise with issue of topics is something I think which other people might also find useful, and this won't take you much. Just take a print out of those 20 pages and allot a day and just spend 5 minutes going through each topic and writing 3 points. That is definitely going to help you. Hello.
Hello, can you all hear me?
Hello?
Yeah. Can you hear me, Sarah?
Yeah, I can hear you. So was the last part audible? I thought I did miss the connection.
Now this AW, I've just shared the links of the pool, the argument pool and issue pool topics with all of you. So ETS raises AWA questions from these two pools. So you can just go through all these topics, the ones which actually Saurabh meant. So you need not necessarily write down all the essays and then just try to memorize. You just can practice. So even if you practice close to 4 to 5 topics, and then if you can see what are the mistakes you do, and if you minimize them, it will be useful. So just go through all the topics, because those are not totally new to you. Now I just want to know, is current affairs or reading the newspaper so important for AWA or reading comprehension, Sarah?
Yeah, it might help, because in AWA what people are looking for actually is something. When you are reasoning an argument, they're looking for facts. And you can just cannot, let's say for example, in my case, the topic was that is branding really important. So I had to quote example from how Apple does its branding. And general knowledge of current affairs, you don't have to read newspapers every day, but if you go through those topics, for example, there was a topic which is really difficult, like scandals are useful. So scandals are useful, You have to know what are the major scandals. When you are quoting examples in that kind of particular topic, you have to know what are the major scandals which happened in the world and what were their implications. Because without facts, your essay won't carry too much weight. So even though, say, we don't have time to go through current affairs every day, for what I'll suggest is that go through that pool, look at what are the things which, let's say, what all topics may require facts, And then you can specifically read about those topics. For example, let's say technology is useful. So what are the technological innovations that have happened in the last 20 years? Or let's say there's a topic called, all discoveries are done by chance. So if you have to support this argument, what are the discoveries that were, accidentally done? So you can focus, advice is that go through current affairs. It will definitely broaden your reading comprehension ability as well as your way to write, present a very balanced, solid stand. But if you may find that you don't have much time, at least prepare facts for those topics. Because if you quote facts, definitely you want to get more score than when you're doing them not.
Wow, that's really nice. Now, Sara, what after your GRE exam, what plans have you got? Your profile, can you share us about your profile, your CGPA?
So, my CGPA is 8.96. It's good, but it's not that great. I need to supplement it. For, at least, let's say if I'm planning for top 20 universities, then it's kind of good, but it's not that really excellent. So, but I have to, definitely I have to write a very balanced SOP now. My SOP and my recommendations, they are going to matter a lot. And I have to present my 2 years of experience in a positive light, how I'm going to use it, how I'm going to use my 2 years of experience, how I'm going to show my whatever work experience that I have to now show how relevant it is to the course or the university that I'm applying. So that is one of the things which will go in my SOP. And I don't have a paper submission which is published yet, so probably that is something I'm lacking, but definitely I have to compensate that somewhere else. And so I'll probably show some of the extracurriculars and some of the academic achievements that I've got in my college. I'm spending time these days, writing the SOP and showing all those things, and again getting a good set of recommendation.
Oh, all right. Saurabh, you didn't mention about the TOEFL exam. Are you planning to take the TOEFL exam?
Yeah, I gave TOEFL exam on 6th of on 8th of November, so I got around 118 out of that. So that is
118 out of 120. That's really great, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, that's really great. So that's really nice, Saurabh. How did you prepare for TOEFL?
I prepared for around 4 to 5 days for TOEFL. So. Yeah, that was more like, so TOEFL is not adaptive, so that was the first thing that was really, pacified my, that calmed me. Yeah, it relieved me really. So TOEFL is all about how well you can answer those questions. So if you're preparing well for RC, if your RC is good, then you can definitely score 30 out of 30 in your first TOEFL section. The listening section is also similar to your RC, and if you're comfortable with English, then probably reading and listening is something that you can easily do. I spend more time in practicing for speaking section, because speaking section is a little tricky, because you are given a topic and suddenly in a minute you have to prepare for that particular, speak on that topic. So I spent about a day or two in practicing for speaking section, and that was the only section which was little different from the entire GRE preparation. So if you are working on your GRE, then your reading, listening and your writing sections are pretty much well covered. Just practice them. Before going to a TOEFL exam, don't go blank. So you don't go blank. Practice from ETS website. ETS has published a exam, two set of exams for TOEFL. Practice. And in my case, you can, and you might want to spend more time on the speaking section. That is my advice would be, yeah.
That's superb. So I generally tell students that your GRE preparation will also help you with your TOEFL exams, but you've actually proved it. So guys, prepare well for your GRE verbal sections, but also pays off for your TOEFL as well with a little amount of revision. So yeah. That's really nice. Okay, so shall we proceed further, guys? How do you find the session? It's really cool and great, helpful, awesome. That's really nice. So now we are going to know about how Saurabh felt on his GRE exam date after all this preparation, after all this guidance which he had got from GRE Edge, after all the efforts he had put. How was the GRE exam day to him? How was it? Is what we are going to ask him. How did you feel on the day of the GRE, Saurabh?
Okay, so yeah, so every exam you feel a little anxious, you and since I there's my slot was on 10 a.m. so the very important thing is that you have to make sure that you get a good night's sleep before the day before. And in my case, I also gave an ETS. I had kept the ETS. ETS publishes a power prep 2 exam. There are 2 sets of examination. So I gave that exam a day prior to GRE. I got 166 in quant and 162. Not exactly what I was expecting in quant, but yeah, I was little. I was sure that if I can minimize, so I got 1 question wrong. So I was sure that if I can minimize my mistakes and little overconfidence in quant, I can score 170. I was confident in once with 162 that I scored, that I got an ETS per part 32. Now for the day of exam, make sure that you have a good night's sleep on the day before, because that's what because concentration is of utmost importance the next day. On the GRE exam, I arrived like 15 minutes before the schedule center. Try to make sure that you reach 15 minutes before the allotted time, so that you're not panicking. You have enough time to settle down, look around, what all your peoples are, what are the other people who are going to give an exam, and you're not intimidated. And yeah, so and it is very important that you strategize yourself on that 30 minutes, because there will be 6 sections, 1 surprise section, and the first section will be AWA. Second section will be verbal, third will be quant, and again a verbal and the quant. And the final section will be a surprise section, which in my case was a verbal section. Now, for AWA, what my suggestion, my strategy was that given a topic, let's say whether it's an analyze an issue or analyze an argument, first write the body. Don't start with the introduction, don't start with the conclusion. Write the 3 main points, because your evaluators are going to evaluate you on the strength of your argument. So write those 3 arguments which you think. Spend first 5 minutes brainstorming what are the ideas that you can get, what are the 3 things that you're going to write on that. If you have more than 3, that's good, that's very good. But at least prepare 3 things in those starting 5 minutes. Write down at least 1 line, or write a balanced paragraph for those 3 points, and spend about 20 minutes writing those the body. In the last 10 minutes, write your conclusion first and then the introduction. And so that's how I strategized my AWA section, because you have to complete your AWA in 30 minutes. And make sure you have some time left for revision, because we might think that, okay, when we are typing, I want to type everything correctly, but believe me, it's not always that. You tend to make mistakes while typing, you tend to make some grammatical mistakes, so it's always important that you save at least 2 to 3 minutes, or at least 5 minutes for when you revise the entire paragraph, because there will be obviously some mistakes that you have made by typing. In the verbal section, my strategy was that if you have prepared vocabulary very strong, then you can quickly ace through text completion and sentence completion questions. Now, even in the for me, I found sentence completion questions little easy, because in sentence completion you have to figure out only 2 sets of synonyms, and if your vocabulary is really good, you can really do that well. So what I did was that in the first 10 minutes, I went through text completion questions which had only a single blank. Because 2 blank question and 3 blank question in text completion, they are relatively difficult and they will take you more time. So what I did was that I first went through single blank questions in text completion, and I finished these sentence completions at a go. And then I attempted all those RCs which had only 1 question, 1 or 2 questions, and which were relatively short. So this took around 10 minutes. In the next 10 minutes, I spent my time going through the bigger RCs which had 3 to 4 questions. And so if you have, let's say, taken this strategy in the first 10 minutes, you would have solved 10 questions. So that gives you a lot of confidence that, okay, now I have a leverage on time. Now 20 minutes are remaining, I have just 10 questions remaining. So next I spent 10 to 10 minutes on solving those those bigger RCs. And in the last 10 minutes, I solved text completion questions which had 2 or 3 blanks. So there were 5 in them. So it took me around 5 minutes, and then last 5 minutes were left for revision. My strategy for quant was to go through all the questions at once and not spend more than 1 minute on each question. So if any question is taking more than 1 minute, I used to defer it for revision. And I used to specifically attempt all those questions which had just a specific answer for it, which were not reasoning based questions. For example, let's say if by reasoning based questions I mean the questions which have a comparison of A and B columns, because these questions are a little tricky, because at times you will find that, okay, this question is a little easy, I can solve it, but you have to evaluate all the angles and all the type of possible cases. So I usually keep those questions for the end, and at one stretch I go through all the questions which take less than a minute, and anything which is taking more than a minute I defer it for end. And sometimes you might find that what happened with my case was that you solved a question and that answer was not in the options. So our general intuition is that we get frustrated. Okay, why I am doing it right? The answer is not in the question. There's something wrong with the answer. Believe me, don't have that attitude. The answers are always right. What will happen is that you will miss something, and you will be you'll arrive at an answer in a different direction, and you have missed. You must have missed. So the general advice in those cases, in those questions, is that you have solved a question once and twice, and still you're getting an answer which is not in the option. Leave that question for revision, and go back at the end of the question. Go and leave the question. Don't get frustrated. Leave that question for revision, and when you're revising, solve that question again with a fresh perspective. Because what usually tends to happen is that in the speed of time, and when our mind is too much anxious, we tend to let's say we are revising the same question again at the same time, we tend to make the same mistake, and that's why we are getting the same answer every time, even though we are thinking that we are solving it right. So for those questions which you are getting an answer which is not in the option, leave those questions for the end and revise them and do them again from start. Don't in a fresh page. So that will help you solve the questions. And in quant, specifically revise all the questions which are reasoning based, column based questions, because they have tricky cases. So that was my strategy for AWA, quant and purple.
Wow, so doing this in so much detail, like every single question you have planned, if I see carefully, doing this in so much detail, that's it. I mean, how many tests did you take before the GRE exam?
So in total, I took three ETS tests and four full-length tests, three full-length tests, yeah, three full-length tests. So five full-length tests, and then took three verbal length full-length tests and two quant full-length tests. So that will be around 7 to 8 tests in total.
Eight tests, wow. So those tests have also paid a lot of importance in your GRE preparation. That's really great. So if every one of us gives so much detailed analysis to all the tests which we take, it will definitely help, I guess. So now, Saurabh, we have a surprise for you. We have a surprise session called the Rapid Fire section. So now what I'll do is I'll just post some random GRE related questions. So you'll have to answer them quickly, just like how you did in your GRE exam. Now this time without a plan.
All right.
Okay. What is your favorite section in the GRE? Is it verbal or quant?
Quant.
Okay. Your favorite GRE word?
Opprobrium.
What does that mean?
Opprobrium means similar to your libel. It's something you're saying against someone, like you are trying to defame them, and it's okay. Really a complicated word, yeah. So
that's okay. Something. How long did it take to memorize that word?
It took me around a day or two. I used to usually confuse that word with something, oppression and all those things. Yeah.
Nice. Which is the most challenging quantitative reasoning topic for you?
It will be status. It will be permutation combination, because you tend to miss out on some cases and you get an answer which is already there.
Okay. Your most challenging verbal section?
It will be AWA.
AWA. Okay. Yeah. So your GRE experience, your overall GRE experience on a scale of 1 to 5, how would you rate it?
With GRE age?
No, GRE experience.
Okay, GRE experience. Yeah, it was fun. Yeah, it was something really. And I rated 4.5. Something I did really cool after college. So yeah.
Okay, your favorite verbal topic. I'm sorry, a quant topic.
Favorite quant topic will be profit and loss.
Profit and loss. All right. Name the person who inspires you throughout.
Steve Jobs, but I don't say for his negative qualities, but yeah, for his positive qualities and enthusiasm and his belief in his ideals and things that he works for. That's great.
Innovation as well. You love innovation, right?
Yeah.
And who is your favorite student facilitator, Kurande Yesu sir or Sumitra ma'am?
Okay, it's if both of them are here, right?
No, just one.
Sumitra ma'am, I'll just say, yes.
Sumitra ma'am. Okay, I'll tell Kurinda yes, sir. Now,
That's a little tricky question.
your favorite GRE Edge feature?
In the learning tracker, the tab that you can see your performance about how well you have performed against all the students who are aiming for similar scores. That's a really cool feature.
That is a performance tracker, progress.
Performance tracker, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so your GRE Edge experience in one word.
Fabulous, that's it.
Fabulous. Okay, a quick word of advice to all the students here.
A quick word of advice, I'd say practice and be confident in what you're doing and don't be afraid of your failures if you're that's a lot of words I'll say. So yeah, practice. Just practice and be confident and believe in yourself.
Wow. All right. That's really nice. Now, how did you, I mean, we just want to know about our GRE Edge from you as well. Now, how did you come across GRE Edge, sir?
So, as I mentioned that during August, I didn't have much time. I was looking for something which can help me prepare online and something which was more personalized experience. And that's when I read about GRE Edge and I learned about this thing that they have one-to-one mentorship, and most of the online programs they tend to become very passive, but this GRE Edge program was very active when your SFAs are actively involved with you, and that was really something which really helped make my decision for GRE Edge and one-to-one membership. And there's always, you are getting consistent feedback from your SFAs, and you know, they are always, you know, mailing you that okay, you're not lagging behind your lessons, to do them properly. So this regular check on your performance is very important, and again they give a lot of they will support you in a lot of ways. They will help you fine-tune your preparation, and yeah, that does a lot. Because for example, at the end I was feeling very much anxious for my AWA, and I asked my SFA for that, and he mailed me a lot of other arguments and a lot of supporting materials which really helped to ease out that part tension. And yeah, so in that case I think it's really great for the SFA and the mentorship section.
Wow. Do you have any best moment? Can you recall one best moment with GRE Edge?
Okay, yeah, I mentioned earlier. So so I was pretty much confident in quant, and when I was thinking that okay, let me finish it. So there's a something called as, you know, your success achievement factor or rate, or how much you're able to achieve your, and I had put down my quant score as 170. So I was 96 point something percent, and I had got 27 out of 28 lessons total. I got 27. In 21 hours, I had outperformed. So when I saw that in the last moment, it was sort of confidence booster.
That must have really boosted your confidence, especially before the exam, right?
Yeah, exactly. So when I got only 166 in my you know, power prep two, I was a little sad. I said, okay, well, I'm getting only 166. I'm aiming for 170. Then I said, and then I just looked at my performance track. I said, okay, I'm performing 27 out of 28. I should be pretty much fine. And I didn't care about my ETS there. So that's a really confidence booster, yeah.
Wow, that's really nice. Thank you, Saurabh. We are really glad that our program helped you a lot. I'll also tell Sumitra ma'am and Kurande sir that you like their training and mentoring very much. I'll definitely convey that. And do you have a message to our audience today?
Yeah, so the audience, my message would be that don't be scared of GRE preparation. So most people lose that, they defer practicing and they say, okay, let me go through the concert first and I'll practice in the end. Don't do that. Practice from the very first day, because GRE is all about practicing, all about conditioning yourself. Like any other exam, it's all about conditioning yourself for that 2.5 hours. Your concentration should be, the entire goal of your preparation should be that for that 2.5 hours, you are able to concentrate. Concentrate very much on what you are doing, and yeah, don't skip lessons. Don't let backlog become too much. Be consistent, be regular, and don't be scared of vocabulary. You might, at times you might feel that okay, there are 3,000 words I've just learned, only 100 or 1,000 words. How am I going to do those 2,000 words? Believe me, if you are consistent in if you have, you know, if by the time you're halfway through your vocabulary, your confidence that okay, now I know 1,500 new words, that's going to propel you faster towards finishing the vocabulary. So believe in yourself, work hard, and yeah, don't get dejected when you're not scoring well. Scores will definitely improve. Focus on your accuracy and yeah, do well. Yes, good.
Okay. To Saurabh, who accepted our invitation, who prepared so well for the GRE exam amidst a very, very busy schedule, who focused more on the GRE preparation in spite of having a challenging work, to a person who has put in so much efforts behind a GRE and also has come so far to share his experience to the budding GRE aspirants, to you, we have one message. This is one thing which we would love to share with you, Saurabh, the message from your SFAs. So they've just shared their wishes to you. So we convey the best to you, or to you. All the best, Saurabh.
Thank you a lot. Thanks a lot.
Contact details of GRE Edge. Okay, you can call us on this number, or you can mail us at this email ID, so that you can get all your GRE related doubts clarified. We'll be happy to guide you regarding your GRE anytime, and we'll be happy to help you in realizing your dream. So all the best once again, guys. All the best. Good night, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.